Welcome back to Research in Focus. I'm Gretchen Huizenga, and today we have a stellar panel to talk about troubleshooting in the data center and how to improve real-time systems with AI and machine learning. And I'm joined by Debadeep Dedai and Besmira Nushi, who are both researchers in the Adaptive Systems and Interactive Group at Microsoft, and also Benaz Arzani, who's a postdoc researcher in mobility and networking. Thanks to each of you for coming today.
Thank you for having us.
Great. So you're all working on research to improve real-time systems with the help of AI and machine learning. So let's start with you, Besmira. Tell us about this work, sort of broad strokes. What's important about it? Why are you doing it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so my research lies at the intersection of human and machine intelligence. And basically, we work and we study systems that combine both humans and machines together to solve the most complex problems that we have today. And we focus mainly in component-based machine learning systems, or in other words, systems that have multiple learning components working together. Mm. And the reason why we do so is because in the last few years, there have been many advances in the field for building single task machine learning components, like for example, object detection components or signal processing. And when you put all these pieces together into a bigger system, like for example, a self-driving car or a factory pipeline, then there are completely new challenges that we need to face as system engineers and as researchers. And of course, you know, troubleshooting and debugging is one of the main challenges that systems engineers face these days in order to understand better their systems and to understand where to improve them next.
So let me toss it to you, Day, because it just sort of dovetails with what Besmira just said. Mm-hmm. Talk a little bit more about the modular nature of systems and why modularity can be good but can also really mess things up.
Sure. So my background is I come from a robotics background, and I have been involved in many teams building like self-driving car software or drone software. And as you can understand, these are all very mission critical, safety critical pieces of hardware and software working together under very resource constrained environments. And it being a very multidisciplinary field, which requires multiple expertise from different domains to come together, be it like electrical engineering, computer science, and then also many subspecializations, there's always it's just because of the social nature and the like the size of the task, people tend to break things up into modules, right? So because it allows for division of labor, one team can take on a module, they can be responsible for it, and they can own it. And we are a large software company, and this is how it works. And also it allows for interpretability, we know what the output of a specific module is. And also allows for the application of domain expertise to be actually applied. Right, and because there are many, many modules which work together in such complicated systems, they can all interact in ways which at the local module level, one may not have designed it for. One may not have thought about that, we are going to keep on improving this module, but when you put it into a big, large system, which is just like putting it on a train, which is running, and then you find that this actually doesn't result in the desired behavior of the overall system, even though the local module is doing really well on its own.
So something individually might get better, mm-hmm. but it might make the whole system worse?
Yeah, absolutely. And this is a very counterintuitive phenomenon that I have observed, and this is also very well documented in systems literature as well as in robotics, that this is a very common occurrence.
Right. So how, as researchers, are you tackling that problem of, individual modules, which are necessary in large systems? Mm-hmm. How are you addressing that now?
So for example, if you think about networking, I have a different take on what Dave was saying, but from a more meta perspective. So with data center networking, we have a lot of different teams that are managing that data center. So we have 1,092 people report to Albert, I saw yesterday. And so these people work in different teams, and each of them is managing or configuring a different part of this network. So, and they can interfere with each other's work, right? So it happens in various different ways, and in systems, the way they handle it now is basically by passing the token to each other, like, now tag, you're it, right?
Yeah.
And that's how it works right now. So one of the things that we're trying to do, actually, is trying to figure out, again, from our side in networking, how to make this better so that we don't have to do this.
Okay, so you've got both people and systems, or components and systems, that have individual jobs within the group, right? And then you've got to try to figure out how, from a research perspective, you don't have both the piece making everything else go wrong, or Bill blaming Dave for something that came in on the ticket that wasn't his.
Yeah.
So, big picture, what's going on in research about this? How are you tackling it?
So, at least in networking, one of the things I'm really excited about is this thing about self-managing networks that's coming up, right? That you want to eliminate the human from the loop as much as you can. And I'm looking at different aspects of this. Like, one of the aspects we're looking at is the ticketing problem we have in Azure. One of the things we've seen is a lot of tickets go to different teams, and they're not really that team's responsibility, and they eat up someone's work time to actually figure out, oh, this is not something I should be looking at. And like, why does some human person have to go and look at that ticket to figure that out? But we're looking at it also from the perspective of security. One of the things we found is our customers don't want to be responsible for installing something inside their VMs to figure out if the VM is ever compromised or not. So the question we want to answer is, can, from a networking standpoint, we figure out if this VM is now compromised or not? So like, there's different angles to this. And I think as researchers, we've become better at identifying these problems and figuring out when machine learning can help and when it can't, because it's not a one-size-fits-all either.
Right. So Basmira, what about from an adaptive systems perspective, that same kind of problem? How would you address that from your point of view?
Yeah, so there are a few properties of machine learning systems that make this work of like self-healing or self-managing failure a little bit more difficult than in traditional software. For example, we know that in machine learning it is very common to say that your component is 95% accurate and that there is going to be a 5% error and that there is uncertainty related to this component. And the question is, when you have all this working together and you have this continuum of quality where everything is failing and succeeding at the same time, how do you put blame into the system?
Right.
This is one aspect, and another aspect is the fact that due to sometimes bad architectural design or due to the fact that there are different dependencies going on in between components and one component may learn from the output of the other component, there might be hidden feedback loops and complex entanglements between these that create artifacts that the system engineer is not aware of. And the question is, how can we ask this what if questions? How can we say what happens if one of the components is fixed or is replaced by another component? And in order to do so, we need strong causal reasoning tools, which means that we need to generate counterfactual analysis to be able to answer these questions.
Right.
And what we do in our work is that we try to generate this counterfactual analysis by mainly introducing people in the loop in order to reduce the cost of troubleshooting. So, to say developers do not have infinite time in trying to implement all the fixes that they can in their system. But what we do is that we provide a sample data set to crowdsourcing workers online on the web, which can check the output of the machine learning components. They can fix this output, and then we integrate it back into the system execution.
Okay.
And this way, we can understand what happens if we were able to really implement this fix.
Right.
And this comes as a report to the system designer so that they can make informed decisions in the future.
Yeah. Dave, do you have anything sort of that from your perspective of what particular things you're working on and how that fits into the big picture?
Yeah. So one of the things we are doing is that, like, in big, large software pipelines, there are lots of parameters, right? Like, every module, if you think, has some free-floating parameters. It could be algorithm choice. It could be on what machine it runs, what protocol it should use to communicate, and, like, how to prioritize even links between various modules. We are looking at, like, you know, coming up with this meta-reasoning approach, which is always present as a shadow shadow in the background as the system is running. And our ultimate dream is that this meta reasoning module will automatically react to changing environments. Like, let's say one computer fails, or like, you know, suddenly like there's another more jobs running on the system. So like now for your particular task, the compute that is available is constrained. Or for a different kind of input comes in, which is making your modules work, behave in weird manner that you had not expected before, or have more latency, because sometimes modules may be context dependent in terms of latency and accuracy. And to reason in real time, like do this meta reasoning in real time on how we can shift the configuration such that, like, you know, the things that the builder of the system cares about, like, you know, that you should have this much accuracy minimum, or you should have this much latency, you should never exceed this much latency, up to this much is okay, right? Or and all these like preferences and constraints, whether they be hard constraints or whether they be soft constraints, can be respected in real time. So we are trying to that's our aim in this project.
Yeah, so drill in a bit on latency and why and where we might see an application of that be really, as you say, mission critical?
So for example, like, you know, I could give you like examples on the web, right? So, and we see this every day. So if you can search something into a search engine and the search engine decides to give you a great search result, except it will give you in 20 minutes, right? That's pretty not useful, right?
I would leave.
Yeah, you would leave and you would be like, the system is not doing what I want it to do. What you would rather take is something which is almost like, you know, in 0.1 second gives you slightly worse search result. That's okay, but it's giving you instantly, right? So there's this, like, depending upon application, and if I put it in a robotics context, a self-driving car driving down the road, if it's empty road and there's nobody around you and it's an empty highway, near empty highway, it's fine for it to take as much time as it needs to make nominal decisions. And even be slightly delayed, no harm, no foul. But suddenly, if you are in a very crowded scenario, and let's say you're still going at high speeds, and somebody suddenly braked very hard in front of you, like this is 405 traffic, for example, right? Waves, it happens in waves. And now you don't have, like, you know, let's say 50 milliseconds or 500 milliseconds to react for your car, self-driving car software to react as it had before. So the luxury, like the time margin has shrunk, and now it's also very critical that it be very accurate in the decision it makes. So depending upon context, your requirements for latency and accuracy can change on the fly, right? And this is where we want to change systems from being nominally built, right? Like systems are usually designed in this, like, for the average case scenario, and we will fix the parameters, but we want to, like, you know, do this meta reasoning on systems.
Right, because real time matters.
Right.
And in the example you gave earlier about, you know, waiting for a web search, that's just a human irritation.
Yeah.
But a self-driving car could have dire consequences if the latency was poor.
Yeah.
Yeah. Beth Naz, when you're working on machine learning systems, what do you consider a contribution to the field?
That's an interesting question, and there's been a lot of debate about this. So at least in systems, what happened was when the first wave of machine learning hit, you had all of these papers, let's apply machine learning to anything that we can get our hands on. It's sort of like what we have now with P4. Everyone wants to do something on P4 switches. And then people got tired of this. So now if you work on machine learning problems on systems, a lot of times the comments you get is, okay, what is your algorithmic contribution? And I think the contribution now to the field is, first of all, identifying what problems need machine learning and what problems don't. That's the first basic thing. And then not just apply machine learning to the problem, but see what insights you can get after you applied machine learning, you saw it works, why is it working? Like, try to get a deeper understanding about the problem you're trying to solve so that you can design better systems based on the result of that. That's what I think what's key. And yeah, not doing machine learning for machine learning's sake, I think, is important.
I mean, at some point, people will say machine learning for everything, but it isn't necessarily necessary, as it were. Well, let's close with what you guys think the goal of this research is. I mean, in a perfect world, aside from, you know, not getting the wrong blame in the data center situation, or, you know, just being irritated for a web search, what does it look like? What does the world look like if you're wildly successful with your efforts in research? Any of you? Go ahead.
I mean, for me, it's if I can see a world where networking engineers get a chance to actually be innovating inside the network rather than being debugged down and figuring out what the hell is going on with the networks that we have so that we can innovate and create things, more things like P4 and SVN and things like that. That, I think, would be an ideal world.
Besmer, what about you?
Well, I guess the final goal is to build reliable and accountable AI. So systems that can operate in the real world and that can operate in helping humans solving their most complex problems. Now, we also have to be aware that we do need theoretical foundations in order to do so, but we also need the right tools and the right AI infrastructure to facilitate the process. Mm-hmm. So I think that we have a lot to do in improving our AI software engineering stack and the AI infrastructure, so that it allows the AI systems to become introspective. You know, like we all are inspired by this ideal goal of being able to create intelligence, but no intelligence is real if it is not introspective and if it cannot question mark itself and be able to, you know, detect its own errors, diagnose its own errors,
and finally fix.
The self-healing physician. How about you, Day?
I think I completely agree with Behnaz and Besmira here. And in addition to the, like, you know, the introspection and self-awareness, also being able to, like, you know, to quote Eric, being able to do value of think computation. Like, is it okay for me to make a decision now? Or am I able to make it with confidence? Do I know that I have all the information I need to make even the decision that I know it with confidence? There's real challenges from decision theory and machine learning and just, like, you know, intelligence in general on making these, like, you know, more prevalent in system design, right? Like from the get-go. So I would love to see a world in which, like, you know, our systems are more intelligent in a self-aware, they are self-aware, they also know what is unknown, and they bring a lot of unknown into the known unknown space so that they know when it is not possible for them to make a decision and they should not rely, or a human being who is in the loop should not rely on the output of the system. And I think even those relatively humble goals, like, you know, even if you set aside self-driving cars and drones and Jetsons and all that, is going to make our world much more nicer.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you, each of you, for coming in today. It's been really fun and educational for me. Day, Besmira, and Behnaz, thanks again. And thank you for coming to this session of Research in Focus, and we'll see you at the next one.